singing over me. You've been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You've been so, so kind to me.
Good morning. My name is Pastor Kellen Rogenbuck. I'm the pastor of Emmanuel United Methodist Church in Jefferson, Wisconsin. And today we are producing what you're watching, which is called New Church. It's an online, virtual, community-based worship experience. And what that means is to get everything out of this experience that we are providing, we encourage you to be in community with one another. That means going down in the comments and introducing yourself, to answer questions, to communicate, to like and share. And so I give you full permission during this entire broadcast, especially right now or especially when someone asks questions, to respond, to answer. This is the best part about doing this online. Nobody's giving you dirty looks because you're talking to somebody in the pews. You're in your living room. You can text, you can share, you can like, you can comment. So take a moment to introduce yourself down in the comments and be a part of community. Please join me wherever you are, however you're watching this, as we enjoy the gift of music and we share that music with our risen Lord. Whether you're singing or you're sitting and reflecting and listening, please join me in this song. Things we do as part of a worshiping body whenever we gather is we pray for one another. We do this because when you are in community, you care about what's happening in your community. You rejoice in the things that other people rejoice in, and you mourn the things that other people mourn. So we take time each week to share the things going on in our lives. This happens down in the comments. So during this section, I invite you to share the joys in your life, things that are exciting, things that are causing you to smile, things that you can't wait to share, but also the concerns and the petitions, the things that you're worried about or stressed about or sad about, the things that it would be nice to know other people are praying about. Now, this morning is very exciting for Emmanuel. We are doing what's called a paracast. What that means is a simulcast is one thing that's being broadcast or happening in many different places. We're doing what's called a paracast, which is two things that are happening at the same time that are different. But in our case, they're different, but also kind of the same. Because right now you're watching New Church, but at our facility in Jefferson, we're also providing an in-person worship experience that is using the same scriptures, the same sermon. I'm preaching it live versus taped right now for you. So these two things are happening at the same time. So fingers crossed, right now in Jefferson, Wisconsin, we're doing the same thing in the building, which is praying for our community. So prayer is that that service is going well. They're praying for you, and we can be praying for them. And it's this very complicated but exciting thing. During this time of prayer, I will begin us in prayer, and then we'll have a time of stillness. During this stillness, this is where you get to pray to God. This is where you can pray out loud or pray in your heart, whichever you're most comfortable with. But you're sharing the things that you're seeing down in the comments right now, the things that people want to share, joys and concerns, and are asking you to pray for. In this time of stillness, I ask that you leave a little bit of space for God to speak back into your prayer life. That's what prayer is a conversation. And a conversation has two parts, you and the other person. And in this case, the other person is God. So we want to leave space for God to speak back into our lives, both in our prayer, but also just in our day-to-day life. At the end of this time of stillness, I will call us back into prayer, and then we can pray the Lord. At the end of this time of stillness, I will call us back into prayer, and then we can pray the Lord's Prayer together. Now, the way I'm going to say it will be up on the screen, so you can follow along and you can read it along and say the exact words that I say, if that's important to you. But I encourage you, if you learned it a different way, to pray it the way that you learned it, because I truly believe the first time you memorized and learned this prayer, that it got written on your heart. And I think that's the most genuine and authentic way to pray to God. So I encourage you to say it the way that you would like to say it, because I think that's most important to God. Will you pray with me? Almighty Creator, today all over your creation, people are lifting their voices in song, in praise, in worship, and in prayer. Today we know that you are all ears, that you are basking in the glory that is our worship, and that you're sitting attentively to hear what we have to say in our prayers. As we lift up the joys and the concerns of those around us, we ask that you remain faithful and that you hear the prayers of your children. Author of reality, one who has made all of us, who directs all of us, who supports all of us, who loves and cherishes all of us. We thank you for all that we have. We ask that you remind us of our blessings every morning, and you stir within us thanksgiving. As we go through this time of prayer and of petition, remind us all of the glory that you bring into our lives every single day and with every breath we take. We ask all of these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. If you have a joy or a concern that you would like to share, but maybe not in the public forum of the comments of New Church, I encourage you to contact the church directly. You can do this through our website, through the Facebook page, by calling, by writing us a letter. You can even contact me directly, Pastor Kellen Rogenbach. And we have a prayer team at the church that's standing by to be praying for you. So you are still participating in community-based prayer, just not quite as public as the comments down below. Today we gather to talk through what we call Palm Sunday. Now, Palm Sunday is the beginning of Holy Week. And Holy Week, by a lot of traditions and a lot of denominations and churches, is considered to be like the most important week of our Christian calendar. And it all starts with Palm Sunday. And I want us to understand what Palm Sunday is, because it really is the like precipice into this intense, like intricate narrative, this story, this drama that starts now and ends with Jesus being put to death in just 5 days. I mean, this, it's like, it's fantastic. I think that you should, sometime you should read it. I will be preaching today from the passages from Mark. I like Mark's version of this. You can find Jesus' last week in all of the different facets in Mark, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in different ways. But Mark seems to be the only disciple that owned a watch. You know, so during his time throughout the week, he'll be like, and it was midday. And like, it helps break up each day so you can understand the flow of things. You can start getting into the momentum of how it all begins with today and how it seemingly ends with Friday. But the story then has this amazing epilogue that is Easter. And we'll talk more about that next week on Easter. But I want you to begin thinking about Palm Sunday with the image that I have in my mind from when I was a child. And maybe you have similar stories from when you were a child, or you remember when the church that you went to, if you went to church, when had children that did this. I have this like vivid memory of Palm Sunday. Like, we would come to church and they would like grab the kids as they were coming through the front door. They'd be like, Kellen, come here. And we'd have to wait in the back until the service began and they do the announcements and everything. And then we have the first song. And the first song was either some Hosanna song that everyone would sing, or some like marching tune that the organ would play. And all the children would march into the sanctuary like this like parade of little people waving palm branches. And we were waving them and sometimes we were like singing Hosanna, Hosanna, whatever, you know. We didn't know. We just did what we were told because we were children. And we'd get up to the front and there'd be a big pot, you know, a big planter full of sand. We'd all stick our palm in there, and then we'd have this like fern looking thing right at the front. And then we'd go sit with our parents, and like that was, we were done with our part. But we had this like very dramatic marching entry, right? And it was to have this like visceral experience to see the palms and the marching and the music and the triumph. And then even at Emmanuel, one of the things that I've done in the past here, and we won't be doing this year as part of our in-person worship, but I do like to do, is I'll lay the palms all down on the floor so we don't wave them, and maybe we will in the future, but when we walk in, we're like crunching on the palms and we're walking into our spot, and you get that feeling, you can smell the palms, you can feel it under your feet. Now, if none of this is making sense because you don't know what Palm Sunday is, don't worry. I'm about to go through it, but I want you to think about this kind of drama, this dramatic, you know, having the smell of the palms in your nose and the feel on your fingers, the sound of them swishing in the air, the crunch under your feet. This is something that the church focuses on often when we talk about Palm Sunday. And it's because this story is quite dramatic. And we do a really great job with that. And then we don't always do a great job of explaining Palm Sunday. So I want to do that for you. I want to spend this time dissecting pieces of Palm Sunday so that we can go from this place understanding better. So I'm going to be using the passage from Mark. It comes from the 11th chapter. If you want to read the last week of Jesus' life here on earth, you can start with Mark 11 and just read it on through. Today we're only going to do the Palm Sunday bit. So if you want to follow along, it'll be up on the screen, or you can follow along at your Bible at home or on your phone. It's going to be Mark 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'What are you doing?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing untying this colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw the cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut from the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. So this is often referred to as the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And the first thing I want you to realize is what exactly is happening. We are going into Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. That's what Jesus is doing here with his disciples. And that's why there's all these people. Now, Jerusalem was a big city, but for Passover, the city would be flooded from all directions with people coming to the temple to celebrate for Passover. Now, we're going to come back to what Passover means in just a moment, but what I want you to visualize is one side of the city having this entry, Jesus on his colt, or in some translations, donkey, coming in on the one side and like everyone just going nutso. But on the other side of the city, way over here, would be a parade of Roman soldiers, tens of thousands of Roman soldiers and Pontius Pilate riding into the city as well. They were not coming to celebrate Passover, but they were coming because of Passover. So let me explain what Passover is, and then you might understand why these two things are converging upon Jerusalem. So Passover is the Jewish festival of celebrating the Exodus, the Israelites escaping to being released out of their bondage and their slavery and their oppression from the Egyptian Empire. If you remember, or if you want to read the story, it's in Exodus. The whole book is called Exodus in the Bible. And that's like the exit, the leaving of Egypt. But the Israelite nation, they were all slaves. And this is where the Moses and the basket, and he gets raised up. And then there's the burning bush and let my people go. And finally, Pharaoh does. But not before the plagues. And we have these 10 plagues that happen in Egypt. And the last one is the hand of death that goes over the land. And if you mark the door frames, this was a covenant that God made with the Israelites. If you mark your door frames, the hand of God will pass over your house and you'll be unaffected. And so that's where Passover comes from, the name Passover. And then Pharaoh finally lets the people go, and they're able to leave their oppression, leave their slavery. Now, imagine you are Caesar, or you are the governing force of an oppressive empire like the Roman Empire. And you know that there's a section of your empire that is made up of lots and lots of Jewish people. And you are oppressing them because that's the oppressive nature of the Roman Empire. And you know that they're all going to get together in one place. Tens, maybe hundreds of thousands of people getting together in one place, celebrating how one time they overthrew, with the help of their God, they escaped the tyranny of oppression in an empire. You might be like, we might keep an eye on this situation. Something might happen here we don't want. And so every Passover, they would send tens of thousands of soldiers into Jerusalem, and the governing bodies would be there to to oversee, to just kind of remind everyone who's boss, and just to keep an eye on the situation. So that's a normal occurrence. That's why Pontius Pilate is even present in Jerusalem. He didn't live in Jerusalem. He was elsewhere governing. And why there's all these soldiers and some of the tensions that are happening that are literally being viewed. Like if you were up on a mountaintop looking at Jerusalem, it's like two storm fronts coming together on the city. The city is like primed for something. There's tension in the air. Meanwhile, at this one over here with Jesus coming into the city, we have all of these people who have heard of Jesus. They know that Jesus is the Messiah and the Savior, and they believe that he is coming to become this King of Kings, that he's going to lead them to a place of a new world order, where the Jews, for the first time in a long time, are not under the foot of anyone. They're not being oppressed by anyone, that they are the top dogs. And we know this because of this song that they're singing and this shouting that's happening. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Now, David was a king that was hand-selected by God. God said, this will be your king. And he led in the most prosperous time of the Israelites' entire history. This is the time that the kingdom flourished and grew and was good. So when we hear about the blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David, we understand that what they think is going to happen is that we're going to return to this time where God has hand-selected a king, and that we're going to triumph over our enemies, and we are going to be the top dogs again. We're going to enter this second time, the second age of the Israelites. And they think that Jesus is this ruler to have it happen. And so when Jesus is riding into town, you have people just losing their minds at how exciting this is for them. They're running and they're jumping and they're shouting, they're yelling these things, they're ripping their clothes off and they're throwing their clothes on the ground, so that the donkey that Jesus is riding won't touch the ground. Like, that is the level of frenzy that this crowd has worked themselves up into. Thousands of people demonstrating and shouting and chanting and yelling and high-fiving and ripping clothes off, pulling up plants from the ground and slamming it down. What we're seeing here is less of a parade as we would think of a parade in our modern times, and more like a demonstration, more like a political demonstration, almost like a protest. We're seeing Jesus riding in, and we're seeing people fill in behind him, shouting and waving their hands and saying, we are going to do this. This is the coming time of Jesus. This is the coming time of our new kingdom. They think revolution is coming. And it's coming now. This would be the time too. Jesus has the Israelites all in one place. This would be the time for an uprising. So imagine that you are one of the religious leaders, maybe not the kind of person who would go see Jesus enter, but also maybe not the kind of person who would go and see Pontius Pilate and the Romans come in. You're just like hanging out in your spot in Jerusalem. You can hear the shouting and this like cacophony from outside the walls as Jesus is coming in. You can hear them yelling and screaming for revolution. Now, this is a scary thing. This is what really sets the tone for the next 5 days for the religious leaders. Now, the religious leaders are part of the structure. They're it's called a domination system. And I don't have a lot of time to go into it, but the way that it works is like, it's like a tier-based system of like people that are in charge of people below them. And so there's the religious leaders in Jerusalem whose job it is to oversee all of the rest of the Jewish people, to keep the peace, to like their one job is to like collect taxes and make sure there's not a revolution. I guess that's two jobs. And they're in Jerusalem, and they hear this like revolution song and chants spilling up over into the city. Now, just a few decades before this, there was an uprising in Jerusalem. And for like a very short period of time, Jerusalem was no longer part of the Roman Empire. And the Roman Empire doesn't like things like that happening. So they sent their whole army in, and everyone was wiped out from the top on down. All of the leaders, all of the soldiers, all of the men. It was just like it was bad. Like, so this is in the mind of those religious leaders being like, this is going to explode. Our city is going to burn to the ground because we have this like Jesus self-appointed army. These people who are like, Jesus is our man and we are doing this. Shouting about the coming time of David. Meanwhile, they can hear the clinking of the armored soldiers coming in on the other side of town. We have this, these, like I said, storm fronts moving together. And over the next 5 days, we see things only escalate. As much as the people tried to de-escalate, it escalates to the point of like this like final de-escalation, which is killing Jesus. They arrest him in the dead of night. So that people, I mean, most people don't even know that Jesus is dead until he's already died. They don't know that he's been arrested until he's already died. That's how fast this all happened. And they did it in such a way that like this whole revolution fizzles out into nothing. Most people think it's a failure. They think Jesus has failed in his mission. Even the disciples think that. It's called Holy Saturday. But it's this time between Jesus dying on Good Friday and Jesus resurrecting on Sunday. Oops, spoiler, sorry. I'll talk more about that on Easter. But in that Saturday, there are tens of thousands of people who think that Jesus has failed. Has failed them, has failed the mission, has failed the movement. So this is just the beginning of that story. And it's interesting, even this story kind of fizzles, right? It's building, building, building. We have this like, Jesus comes in and he's like, I'm in Jerusalem. Whoa, look at the time. We need to go back to Bethany. He just leaves the city. He comes in to do nothing. He comes in to look around and then he goes back home to like where he's staying. But we get enough from this text, from these 11 verses to understand that this is the beginning of a political thriller that builds and builds and builds into this powder keg where a single spark will blow up the city. And in that time, this is part of the motivation for a lot of the different people there and what happens to Jesus. And so what I want you to think about this coming week as we move through each day, and hopefully as you're reading along in Mark with what happens each day all the way up to our Good Friday, is you start thinking about the drama, the tensions, the situations that had to go just the way that they did to have this end the way that it does. And that you remember that Jesus did ride into Jerusalem, that he did have a mission. He did have a purpose. He was blessed and he was coming in the name of the Lord. And he was ushering us out of oppression and bondage. But it wasn't the oppression and bondage of the Roman Empire. It was the oppression of sin and the bondage of death. That is what Jesus brought. And he didn't fail. He succeeded. And we're going to hear about that next week when we talk about Easter. So over the next 5 days, I want you to remember the story, the drama, the stations, the passion, the time of today, of Fig Monday, of Holy Tuesday, of Spy Wednesday, of Maundy Thursday, of Good Friday, of Holy Saturday, all the way until we are here again to talk about the miracle, the blessing, the world shifting, changing, the creation changing. It's not even that it changed the world. It changed the very creation of humanity in 7 days. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, be with us as we prepare for Easter. as we remember the tensions and the amping up and the forward momentum that we have towards the cross. But we remind that that is not the ending, that there's another chapter that is the empty tomb. Bring us back here safely next week so we may celebrate and remember Hosanna in the highest heaven, that Jesus has come. Amen. Whenever we hear the word of God, we should be called to action. One action we take every time we gather, even when we gather virtually, is giving back to the community through the church. The church has its own mandate, that we have a mission that we have to focus all of our actions through. And this mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ through the transformation of the world. And we have a vision on how we do that locally. And it's meeting people where they are, wherever they might be, and showing them the love of Jesus Christ in their life. A lot of times this translates into feeding them or helping them with their debt or their current circumstances, their health, whatever is oppressing them in that time. And while we're doing it, showing them what it means to be loved like Jesus loves and sharing the gospel with them. And that's everything we do here, from new church to our in-person worship to all of our ministries and outreaches, things like Ruby's Pantry, like our haircuts, like our pop-up pantry, down to the small things we do each and every day as Christians in our discipleship and in our evangelism. And so when we get together like this, we think of how we can make a bigger impact, because we are called to make disciples of all nations, and that's a lot of people. Even in our community, there are thousands of people who are not parts of churches. There are thousands of people here in Jefferson, even, who don't know the love that Jesus Christ has for them. And so together, we are bigger than we are. We are more powerful. We have more resources together than we do on our own. So we pool those resources. We use our time, our talents, and our financial resources. We use our time to volunteer. We use our talents to serve and to do what we can in the ways that we can. And we pool together our financial resources so that we may make a bigger impact with more resources than we could on our own. So I ask you today to consider how you do those things, how you use your time, how you use your talents, how you use your financial resources to come together with the mission and vision of our church and our community. You are part of our community just by watching this, just by participating. And so I want to invite you to be a part of what we have going on here, because it's really important. We are building a new world, a better world, a world that is the kingdom of God. To steal a line from today's scripture, the kingdom of our father David, the kingdom of God, a place where God rules and everyone has a better life and knows the love of Jesus Christ. That's what we're going for. So if that's something you want to be a part of, I certainly hope that you do. That's what we're all about here. There are two ways that you can do that. You can be connecting through our in-person location. You can either be coming on a Sunday to connect with us, or you can be mailing things in. You can be communicating that way. You can be sending your resources in through the mail with an envelope, with a stamp, with an address. You like it, you close it, you send it in. If that's what you want to do, this is our physical location's address. Or you can do all of these things virtually. You can be connecting through Facebook to volunteer or find out information about volunteering or using your time and talents. And when it comes to your financial resources, you can go to emmanueljefferson.com and you can click on the Giving tab. This is a way that wherever you are, wherever you're accessing the internet, through your phone, through your tablet, through your computer, you can digitally send support that way. And we pull it all together and we do as much good as we can with what we have. So I invite you to be a part of this community in that way, in building a new world. Let us again take a moment to come together, to put our voices together and sing or listen and reflect, but raise up the majesty and the beauty that is music to the ears of our Lord.
The King of love, my shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I'm nothing like if I am his, and he is mine forever. And he is mine forever. Rejoicing brought me in death's dark veil. I fear no ill with thee, dear Lord, beside me. Thy rod and staff, my comfort still, thy cross before to guide me.
As we come to the close of another episode of New Church, there's a few things I want to share with you and remind you of or tell you about. The first thing is that during Holy Week, through the next 5 days, I'm going to be trying to do Facebook Lives on key times and key moments throughout the week. I don't know that I'll be able to do it every single day and every single moment, but we will have some information about Maundy Thursday, and I'll do a video on Good Friday. That you can be learning more about those days as they happen so that you can experience the drama and the narrative that flows right into our Easter Sunday. Which brings me to my next announcement, which is next week is Easter. We will continue to be having New Church for you at home and you wherever you are. And it will still be just like we're doing now, but we'll be celebrating Easter. And we are also going to be continuing our in-person worship experience, which happens at 9:30 at our location in Jefferson. And so if that's something you want to be a part of in person, you're welcome to do that. Or you can stay a part of New Church. That's wonderful too. That's why we provide both experiences, because community is happening in both places. And I want everyone to understand that we are community, whether we are in person or we're through New Church. The other thing I would ask you to do as part of New Church, I just heard an amazing story this past week. Someone shared with me that their neighbor walked up and said, you know, I would really like to go to church with you when you start going back in person, because I've been watching New Church. You keep sharing it on your Facebook page. And this person didn't know that this was happening. This was a complete surprise to them. But by clicking the share button and clicking the like button on this video, you're opening up that opportunity that people in your life, even people that you aren't necessarily pursuing as people who might be a part of our community, they're invited into this experience. And they begin to understand what we do here at Emmanuel, or what we do as part of New Church, and what we do is this community. And it's amazing. And the Holy Spirit is touching people in that way. So I really encourage you right now, click the like button, click the share button, go down and comment. This is how people get to be welcomed in through the miracle and mystery of technology. So do that now, please. Jesus told his disciples to go now and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And we remember this call as we remember the last week of Jesus' life. And we remember the story of the gospel that doesn't end with the cross, but continues through the open tomb for us to go through with Jesus into this new world that we are building, this world of discipleship and evangelism and love and acceptance and hope, the hope that is Easter. So I hope you'll come back next week so we can talk more about that. Have a great week. I'll be praying for you.